The judge presiding over this case certainly seems to find this as suspicious as we do. Judge Sullivan is now ordering the special counsel to file any and all 302s or other summaries and reports with the court before the sentencing takes place. Joining me now to break this down, Congressman from Florida's 1st Congressional District, Representative Matt Gaetz. Congressman, thanks for joining me, sir.
Oh, thanks for having me, Liz. And certainly the federal judge may end up in this case getting a lot farther along than members of Congress have, because it is the origins of these charges, whether against Michael Flynn or Paul Manafort, that seem to be driven more by politics than the actual investigative work. That's what gives us a cause for concern. And it sounds like the judge smells like might be something fishy here, because the judge wants to see all of the information that has not been yet produced.
Right. And do you believe, given the information that we have, perhaps information that you have in a classified nature that we do not have, do you believe that there are more than one report, more than one 302 report written by the FBI in regards to Flynn?
I actually don't know, but it would be very unusual for them to have the initial conversation with Flynn without a 302. That would be evidence of another violation of the processes and procedures that the FBI and Department of Justice are supposed to be able to present. But what we do know, and I think you pointed it out in your summary, is that there was never a time in the initial Flynn interview where he showed the indicia of lying, where he indicated, you know, that he was sweating, that he was diverting his eyes, any of the things that people do. That's what James Comey testified to. So whether that was written down contemporaneously or not, it would seem that it would have been. And if the judge is able to access that information, then what it really shows is that the prosecution of Michael Flynn wasn't about his crime. The prosecution was about gaining leverage against Donald Trump. And that's what I think is most troubling about a variety of these prosecutions. They're not really about holding the people accountable. They're creating prosecutions in order to try to create leverage against the president.
Right. Well, that's the thesis of my entire introduction. Was this a trap set by the FBI? Were they trying to catch Michael Flynn by setting him up for failure, by failing to warn him that the two FBI agents that came to visit him in his office, that it would be a crime to tell him his truth to them, even though it didn't seem like an official interview at the time? When James Comey made that decision not to warn General Flynn that anything that he would say is essentially under oath, that because you can't lie or tell a mistruth to a federal investigator. I mean, Comey bragged about this in testimony this week. He said, we wouldn't have gotten away with behavior like this had the Trump administration been as organized as the Obama administration or the Bush administration.
Yeah, and it also shows the odd nature of how they chose to staff that interview, Liz. I mean, Peter Strzok, give me a break. This is the same Peter Strzok that was on the Hillary Clinton email investigation, who was part of paving a yellow brick road for Hillary Clinton, who then ends up in the FBI Trump-Russian investigation, and then ends up on the Robert Mueller team. And so anything that Strzok would have developed from an evidence standpoint, anything he would have come into the chain of custody of, it would be fruit of the poisonous tree, because he demonstrated such hatred for Donald Trump. He talked about insurance policies against the Trump presidency. He said, we'll stop him, and was clearly using this leverage generated against Flynn, even in an event that might have been Flynn just misstating the facts rather than intentionally lying, using that to try to create leverage and to create a media narrative, frankly, that, oh, all the people around President Trump are bad people. Here, the reality is Michael Flynn was engaged in regular, common transition work. He may have misstated elements of that to the FBI, but no indication that there was any intent. If I was Donald Trump, I would pardon Michael Flynn. I would pardon Paul Manafort for the crimes that were committed, you know, allegedly like a decade before Donald Trump even thought about running for president, because those aren't about holding the individuals accountable. They're about creating a political narrative.
Right. And when we're talking about this political narrative that I think the FBI took part in creating here, when we're talking about this potential trap that the FBI set for Michael Flynn, the FBI, remember, knew that Michael Flynn had talked to the Russian ambassador Kislyak, because they had wiretapped the conversations that Kislyak had with different people. Now, ordinarily, when a foreign subject is being wiretapped by U.S. intelligence, the names of American citizens that he or she is communicating with are redacted for the privacy of American citizens, because the government's not allowed to snoop on private citizens. The Obama administration, remember, unmasked Michael Flynn's name. That's how Peter Strzok and the FBI knew that Kislyak was talking to Michael Flynn, but they didn't bring him those transcripts in that meeting and say, listen, we need to talk about this. You need to answer some questions we have about your conversations. They didn't tell him at all what their ultimate goal was. They just tried to trick him into lying about those conversations when arguably they shouldn't have even known that it was his name associated with the Kislyak conversations in the first place.
Yeah, and it shows the coordinated nature of all of this. We continued to see in Peter Strzok and Lisa Page's text messages, you know, wanting to keep the White House informed, knowing that the White House is running this. And I think that dovetails with the fact pattern you laid out about White House officials, Sally Yates, unmasking Michael Flynn for the sake of trying to taint the Trump transition and to try to pollute Donald Trump's ascendancy to the presidency. And so from the White House to the deep state elements that have been exposed by our investigations, you seem to see an effort to target Michael Flynn and then try to make life as difficult for him as possible so that Mueller could get him to say whatever they wanted. And by the way, this isn't just a tactic that they've played out with Flynn. You see time and again Mueller threatening witnesses that if they don't ascribe to his version of the facts, not necessarily what happened, but what he wants to say has happened, that then he will bring other consequences to bear in their lives. And it's really one of the reasons why the special counsel is a flawed system, because we're not investigating actual crimes, we're investigating people. And I think that that really erodes our sense of liberty in the country.
Right. And remember, General Flynn pled guilty to this one count of lying to federal investigators in order to protect his son from investigation, because the FBI was threatening to investigate his son if Flynn didn't plead guilty here. It just smacks of all the unethical tactics that you can possibly imagine. Congressman, last question here. I think we, the American people, understand exactly what you laid out. We understand the wrongdoing on the part of the FBI, even when we don't have the entirety of the facts, because many of the facts are still classified or at least haven't been released publicly yet. But what can we do? What can Congress do to hold accountable the FBI and the Department of Justice and high-ranking intelligence officials that served in the Obama administration who did abuse their power and potentially either set up or outright violated the rights of American citizens?
Yeah, the most important thing to happen is actually from the White House and from President Trump. We have asked President Trump to declassify these 302s. To also declassify the 302s from the George Papadopoulos interviews, and really to allow the American people to see the FISA application that Rod Rosenstein, the Deputy Attorney General, signed, going back even all four of them that were initially executed and then subsequently renewed, so that it can be laid bare before the American people what a ridiculous witch hunt this is. There was never any evidence to open this investigation. It was all kind of a ham and eggs routine, and I think if we can bring transparency into that FISA process, people will see that there was never a legitimate basis to begin any of these investigations. But that's not the work of Congress. That's what the president needs to do.
Well, that's what we need to call on President Trump to do then, declassify all this information so the American people can see the truth and justice can be served. Congressman Gaetz, thank you so much for being on the show, sir. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Liz.
All right, guys, don't go anywhere. Liberals love to peddle the narrative that Michael Cohen is going to jail, therefore, President Trump is guilty of campaign finance law violations. But that is not true. In fact, Michael Cohen himself may not have been guilty of campaign finance law violations, and neither is President Trump. We're going to break that down shortly. Plus, California is trying to put a new tax on text messages. You send a text, you can get text.